e dopo a un certo momento vennero gli studenti e erano lasciati da soli, decidendo definitivamente di abbandonare l'edificio torre e di trasferirsi qua. Diciamo poi il grosso trasferimento è avvenuto un paio d'anni dopo, dopo un periodo in cui c'erano gli studenti, c'eravamo gli altri, era ancora un po', diciamo, da completare.
Comunque comodo questa,
sì,
trasloco,
si
gira. Ma invece lì a via Mazzolo c'è un dipartimento di fisica solo o c'è anche qualcuno?
No, c'è la chimica, l'ingegneria, un grande complesso che poi adesso si è esteso anche al di là del canale, perché via Mazzolo scorre lungo un fiume, al di là l'università prima quella da tanti anni. Preso, costruito il polo,
e sono edifici nuovi, e tutti edifici nuovi.
Sì, o sì, c'è? Sì, no. Sì. Beh, via Mazzolo è degli anni 30,
quando pre-guerra, periodo del fascismo. E beh, come la sede nuova della Sapienza, Piazza Aldo Moro,
sì,
anni
20,
23. Fatta da Piacentini.
La fisica fu l'edificio di fisica, fu costruito nel 36 e da un po' prima, insomma, viene inaugurato nel 36, il primo direttore fu Bruno Rossi e dopo fu licenziato perché Meo dovette andarsene e divennero solo Stagni che è rimasto direttore, allora si faceva direttore a vita fino al 78-79, ero
sì. Mi ricordo, ciao, come stai? Mi ricordo, infatti, Cimino, noi abbiamo avuto, è stato l'ultimo direttore a vita, ciao, dell'osservatorio, e quando morì divenne direttore Pietro Giannone, che però era già della nuova, diciamo, modalità, che è cambiata poi ulteriormente.
Me lo ricordo, sì.
Te lo ricordi?
Sì, sì.
Ti ricordi che c'era quel problema alla gamba?
Poi mi ricordo che bisognava lasciare tutti in perfetto ordine prima della chiusura delle due. Ogni giorno bisognava rimettere a posto.
Le due?
Sì, tutti i libri, tutta la roba. Perché...
Ciao Raffaele, come stai? Dopo un po' di tempo. Altri tempi. Mi ricordo che poi lui, non so qui, ma lui Cimino, come per un periodo forse anche Giannone, mi sa che Giannone ha interrotto, viveva nell'osservatorio, c'era la residenza.
Anche lui. Io negli uffici, prima era la camera da letto del soggiorno. No, del soggiorno.
Ah, ecco. vita, perché c'è il traffico, sei stanco, le collaborazioni spesso e volentieri crollano per questi motivi qua, nella vita reale.
Sì, lì purtroppo è il primo, perché le comunicazioni sono molto infelici, il traffico a Roma.
Sì, è pesante, ma poi più che altro sono i servizi pubblici. Alla fine il traffico automobilistico non è nemmeno così tragico come uno penserebbe che fosse, visto la scarsezza dei servizi pubblici. Per cui alla fine effettivamente conviene prendere la macchina anche per fare cose che da qualsiasi altra parte si farebbero con un servizio pubblico, perché i bus sono lentissimi, le metropolitane ci si esplodono un giorno su uno, no?
Io mi ricordo quell'anno passato a Roma.
Ah, quello lì quando stavi da... Che poi tu stavi abbastanza comodo,
sì,
perché andare a Montemario, insomma, da lì non
era troppo la metropolitana,
sì,
a piedi,
sì, a Lepanto, dove andavo.
Ottaviano,
sì, no,
da lì si poteva prendere.
Da lì potevi.
Piazza del Siero,
sì, sì, che arrivava su a Piazzale, quello che l'ha chiamato il bel sito.
Sì, esatto.
Dove ci sono, e poi lì dovevi farti la camminatina a piedi. Però non era brutto, perché c'è anche la possibilità di entrare nel parco Mellini,
sì, esatto.
Quella sola.
Da quando dovevo andare o per, che ne so, al Savoiardi, alla Sapienza, oppure non ne parliamo, nella zona degli osservatori, nella zona delle proprio,
a Montepozzo,
Montepozzo
poi ci sono solo dei bus che partono dalla stazione Anagnina, che è l'ultima,
sì,
della,
sì,
metropolitana. Però già arrivare alla stazione Anagnina non era uno scherzo.
Un'ora, esatto. Va bene.
Poi la più breve e l'ultimo tratto. Poi adesso sai che a Roma abbiamo l'invasione dei pullman turistici giganteschi per prendere 4 soldi, no? Il nostro sindaco fa viaggiare tranquillamente i pullman turistici nelle corsie preferenziali dei bus. Per cui è un caos, ma veramente per 4 soldi poi.
Ma è che Roma è adesso non so, sei, sono tanti anni che non penso, cioè, ci vado di tanto in tanto, ma è un morti e fuggi. Non so se sia molto, sicuramente sarà molto cambiato.
Però rispetto a quel periodo in cui stavi tu è cambiato un pochino in peggio, ma per altre cose in meglio. Hanno ristrutturato molti edifici, quindi quello è meglio.
Cioè, l'atmosfera di Roma è molto...
È piacevole. Specie per uno che sa che ci può stare un periodo limitato. Specie quando sei in maggio, giugno, che la sera quel lavoro te ne vai un po' di giro.
Io mi ricordo che molto spesso alla sera, alle 10, uscivo di casa,
ma poi stavi lì a prendere via.
E andavo in casa, insomma, che ho giusto fatto parte. Era uno spettacolo.
Poi lì, quella zona, una volta, adesso un po' meno, c'era anche qualche piccolo bar, qualche posto, uno si sedeva. Adesso sono più cose turisticizzate, lì invece erano più...
Io mi ricordo, andavo quasi sempre, alla sera, in ristorante, si chiamava La Vedena.
Sì, lo so qual è.
E c'ero in pratica solo io, non una volta chiacchierato col padre romano, dove vai, lei... il professore Renzi, perché sapeva chi era, perché era amico di Renzi. Professore Renzi, preoccupi, perché io di solito gli faccio a mezzogiorno. Qui c'è mezzo ministero di
Renzi. Ah, forse sì, forse dobbiamo cominciare.
Ah, sì. Va bene, inglese, italiano?
English.
It is a pleasure to have with us today Professor Roberto Capuzzo Dolcetta. Roberto graduated in Rome, if I remember correctly, in 77.
Yes.
Yes, and soon after 3 or 4 years of fellowship, he got the position of assistant professor at the University of La Sapienza. later in the year 2000 became associate professor at the same university. Roberto is internationally well-known scientist on dynamics, as the title of the talk today. He's author of a long list of papers. It has been member and collaborators of various scientific groups. He spent a part of his activity in the United States, where he collaborated with people, in particular Paul Hodge. I think that your involvement in star clusters goes back to his time. And he also taught in the United States for some time. And he was a member of various committees, in particular related to computing, computer science, at national level and also European level. And just to highlight another aspect of his activity, he was involved for a long time in the, actually it was the representative of the national community of physicists in the National Council for University, the so-called CUN. He was our reference point in that very important committee at the national level. So, thanks again for coming. I think that everybody will enjoy your talk. And just to finish, Roberto has, his family comes from Veneto.
Exactly.
Moved to Rome, to Milano first and then to Rome. Long time ago, but yesterday at dinner, he told us that his family come from Veneto.
Exactly from Castelfranco Veneto, to be precise. Treviso.
Okay.
Thank you, Cesare. It's very nice for me to be here to see some old friends like you and others here in the audience. And just to start, I want to give you a short souvenir of a conference that we organized many years ago, just 30 years ago, so it's exactly the birthday. And this is the proceeding by the Kluwer, where we were together with another very good scientist and friend of ours, Alberto Di Fazio, who now retired. Okay, so I'm happy to be here, and now starting with the scientific things. Okay, what I'm going to tell you today is something that I think it will be not so specific in what I am doing. There is a final part where I refer to my recent work, but just to give you a sort of scheme of what is the scale, time and length scale connection in our and in other galaxies. Okay, as everyone knows, the dark matter scale is of the order 100 kiloparsecs. So, and the distance of the sun to the center of the galaxy is of the order of 10 kiloparsecs, so a factor 10 less. We have the non-spherical bulge, which is of the order of 100 parsec dimension, and we are going down to the scale, and we go to the center of the galaxy, where we have a nucleus, which is smaller, of course, than the bulge, for another factor 100, more or less, and it is quite spherical because this is expected. Where gravity dominates, the structure goes to the minimum energy configuration, which is usually spherical. But we can go down for another 1,000 in the scale and go to the milliparsec scale around the putative supermassive black hole in the center of the galaxy. Okay. So I'm going to talk about compact massive objects in the center of galaxies. So compact massive objects are, of course, massive and compact, but they can appear in two different ways. So almost in a singular fashion, so they are massive black hole and even supermassive black hole, and the mass range is from 1 million solar masses up to the one in M87, for example, of the order a little less than 10 to the 10 solar mass. When they are a little less massive, they are not compressing a singularity, they are composed by a plurality, an enormous number of stars, which are orbiting one around the other in the so-called nuclear, because they are in the nucleus, in the center of galaxy star clusters, and the total mass is from something comparable to a globular cluster size up to something which is in the range of the massive black holes, but a little less, so from 10 to the 5 to 100 million solar masses. So what about the host galaxies of these compact massive objects sitting in the center? Yeah, almost all galaxies contain either massive black hole or nuclear star cluster, and there is a signature for brighter galaxy. The hosts are usually cored, and they host more massive and more compact objects. So very bright galaxies usually host singularity in the center, while fainter galaxies, whose luminosity and density distribution is more peaked to the center than the brighter, usually host less massive and compact objects out of the singularity. So in the form of nuclear star cluster. But this is not a precise law because there is some superposition of the two possibilities. Okay, so what about nuclear star cluster? Nuclear star cluster are interesting objects, probably more than the singularity, because you know the singularity is a singularity. There is not anything particularly interesting around a singularity because you know the geodesic, analytical, and so the motion, etc. Well, nuclear star cluster are composed by an enormous quantity of objects with a mass up to 10 to the 8, and they are the densest environment in the universe. So up to 10 to the 6, 10 to the 7 solar masses per cubic pass. So imagine that the average density around the sun is 1/10 of solar masses per cubic pass. So we here are up to 10 to the 8 times the local density in our environment. So it is probably a place where the dynamics is really violent and out of the normal stage and normal states we know in our local solar environment. Okay, so they are sitting in the center of galaxies, of course, and all galaxies, more or less, over all the Hubble types, host a certain fraction of nuclear star cluster. We can say that about 75% of late-type spirals host nuclear star cluster in the center, about half, 50% of early-type spirals host nuclear star cluster, and spheroidal, elliptical, and zero galaxy are almost in the same situation of late-type spirals. So to more than two-thirds of spheroidal and elliptical, etc., galaxy host nuclear star cluster in the center. So what is interesting is that nuclear star cluster, a little at variance with respect to globular cluster, hosts both a young component, young stellar component, a young population, and a whole population. And this is quite tricky and interesting when you try to interpret the formation and evolution of nuclear star cluster. To give you some idea of what I was saying before about the dependence on the luminosity distribution of the host with the presence of nuclear star cluster or not, we have here some figure from the advanced camera, Hubble Space Telescope advanced camera survey for the Forna cluster, and we have five different galaxies in the Forna cluster, from the brightest to the faintest, and we see that the luminosity profile of the galaxy is almost core for a very bright galaxy and show even more evident going to the fainter magnitudes of over density in the center, which is actually called nuclear star cluster. So the fitting of the luminosity profile for faint galaxy in the Forna cluster or in the Virgo cluster or wherever is necessarily given by two different profiles, one very peaked to the center and another one for the more diffuse overall background for this faint galaxy. Okay, this is again the same thing but for the Vigo cluster, and you see that on top you have a very bright galaxy host and they are almost core, etc. When the host luminosity for this galaxy were going to fainter total luminosity of the galaxy, we see clearly the presence of a compact distribution of stars in the very center. And so you have two very different way to fit the overall distribution with a galactic background component, this one which is dashed, and another one which is a sort of supercluster, indeed a nuclear cluster, in the center. This is a more clear evidence of this fact, with a very low mass nucleated galaxy in the Virgo cluster, which is this one, VCC 107. So, okay, you clearly see the two different components, etc., etc. On the right side, I have another plot which gives the probability to find nuclear star cluster in galaxy, where in the composite set of Virgo cluster galaxy, Fornax cluster galaxy, the Milky Way M31, so a certain set of clusters, which show that this is the diffraction of galaxies hosting a nuclear star cluster respect to the total for different luminous masses of the host. So you see that very faint, very light galaxy do not host actually nuclear star cluster, but the number of nuclear star cluster hosted in galaxies is increasing up to almost 100% for a host galaxy mass around between 10 to the 9 and 10 to the 10. Okay, pay attention, this is the luminous mass, so this baryonic mass, stellar mass. And there is a steep decrease of the presence of nucleation for bright galaxy. What does it mean, and is it relevant? Of course, probably yes, but maybe we needed some better and more precise investigation of this. So there is a paper a couple of years ago done by me and a PhD student in Rome, where we simply collected what was available in the literature, very dispersed and very sparse in the literature. It wasn't an easy work to try to make some clear correlation between galaxy and their central massive objects. I mean, nuclear star cluster on one side and massive black hole on the other side. So what did we get? We get information for more than 500 nuclear star clusters in galaxies, of which 220 were found in nearby galaxies, and a larger fraction due to the Hubble Space Telescope surveys in Virgo, Fornax, and Coma clusters. And we found some relevant, significant, reliable data for 135 massive black holes in various galaxies. Okay. What we see at first, something that confirmed previous work, is that there are some cases, but not too many, where galaxies are hosting in the center both a massive black hole and a surrounding nuclear star cluster. But this is just, 10% of the total. And in this case, quite interestingly, the mass of the massive black hole and of the contemporary existing nuclear star cluster are almost the same. So the mass ratio is almost the same when they are both present in the center of a galaxy. These three plots are a sort of summary of that paper. This is the population of three different massive objects in that set of galaxies we studied. In red, there is the nuclear star cluster sample as a function of the integrated magnitude of the host galaxy. In green, the massive black hole sample, and in blue, the subsample of the evident AGNs in this galaxy. As expected, there is almost a superposition between the population of the black holes and of the AGN due to the normal standard way to interpret AGN as active black holes, very massive black hole, while there is a partial superposition of the nuclear star cluster population and the massive black hole population. Clearly, nuclear star clusters are present in faint galaxies, while massive black holes are much more abundant in massive galaxies. On the right side, I have two correlations of the mass of the compact object as a function of the host galaxy mass and as a function of the velocity dispersion of the host galaxy. Okay, here the red dots are the nuclear star cluster, while the massive black hole population is represented with gray dots with some errors. Okay, there is a difference in slope which is a linear dependence, almost a linear dependence, of the mass of the black hole as a function of the host galaxy mass, and a power 2/3 for the nuclear star cluster. So there is clearly a different slope, and this different slope, even if this plot is quite a mess, is present also in the relation of the compact maximum object versus the sigma of the velocity dispersion of the host galaxy. It is well known that the dependence of the mass of black hole over the host galaxy sigma is a very steep one, of the order of 5, while with some care in dealing the data for the nuclear star cluster, it is seen that the slope is much, much smaller for the nuclear star cluster mass versus sigma relation. So there are at least three pieces of evidence that nuclear star cluster and massive black hole maybe are ubiquitous in galaxies, but they have different signatures, so they are probably not so easily connected one to each other in the way of the interpretation of their formation and evolution. Okay, let's talk a little bit about something that rises to the mind when speaking about self-gravitational systems which are spherical, similarities. Okay, on the left side we have the singularity, which is by definition a spherical system, because you know you have the Schwarzschild solution, which is the easiest way to solve the general relativity equation in spherical symmetry. So the characteristic of the mass, there is a typical scale length, which is the Schwarzschild radius. And the density, yes, okay, we can define the density even if a supermassive black hole is a singularity, because we consider the mass within the Schwarzschild radius divided by the volume. What is apparently striking, not for who is working in that, might be for young students, is that the density defined this way for a black hole is low. For our massive black hole in the center of galaxy, we have, making this computation, which is simply the mass divided by the Schwarzschild radius, is of the order of 2,000 or 3,000 solar masses per cubic parsec, which is a low density respect to what is evident in a nuclear star cluster. And of course, it is scaled inversely with the mass of the black hole. If we go to M87, we have a massive black hole which is of the order of 10 to the 3 times the one in our galaxy. You have 10 to the 6 less density than the typical density of a supermassive black hole in our galaxy. This is quite no. I mean, this is nothing new. If we have a nuclear star cluster, we have a length scale of the order of 4 parsecs, much larger than this, and the density is of the order of 10 to the 6 or so. Location, galactic center, inner parsecs, because you know you have an object with a dimension, so the location is uncertain, at least for the scale of the dimension of the object. And we have on the other side something which is the closest object in the sky to the nuclear star cluster, which are the globular cluster. But globular cluster are less massive than the nuclear star cluster, but they have almost the same size, and so they are less dense. And the location is more or less spread out over the galaxy. So the location is of the order kiloparsecs against parsecs against zero, I mean galactic center. So is it possible that nuclear star clusters are in some sense The legacy of the evolution of globular cluster, yes, there are a lot of papers about some discussion, etc. But of course, you need a way to shrink the kiloparsec scale down to the parsec scale, because the location is different. How is it possible? Okay, there is a possibility. What is called the migration to the center of the family of old, very massive, disappear globular cluster, because we know that now we have 200 globular clusters in our galaxy, which are spread out over kiloparsec, and their mass is up to 10 to the 6 or so. But what about more massive, primitive globular cluster? They could have been migrated to the center due to dissipationless merger, so essentially due to what is called dynamical friction, and giving rise to a contraction of a factor 1000 of the distribution. So from kiloparsec to parsec is a factor 1000. So I don't want to go into detail and computation, etc., but I want just to say that with the back on the envelope calculation, you can see easily that this contraction of a factor 1000 is not unrealistic. It's something that is requires just a variation of the orbital energy for a factor 3. So this is the back on the envelope calculation, in the sense that you suppose you have a sort of bulge where a globular cluster is orbiting in the simplest orbit you can think about, which is a circular orbit. You put your a globular cluster of a given mass, is independent of the mass, in the external potential with the dimension of the orbit or the order of 1 kiloparsec. And this is the orbital energy of that object. It is one half of the mass of the bulge times the gravitational constant times the radius of the orbit. Okay, if you imagine a shrinking of the orbit of 1 kiloparsec down to 1 parsec, so 1,000 factor, you see that the orbit is just minus 3 halves. Okay, so there is a factor 3. So it is not an enormous dissipation of energy. It is quite likely. But of course, it depends over certain of details that we are not talking about. Okay, what is the possible reason for this dissipationless decay of scale? It is what is called dynamical friction. Probably most of you know what is dynamical friction. Maybe to remind a little bit is not bad. Okay, you have an object which is a very massive and which is moving in this direction from left to the right. It induces an asymmetry in the overall stochastic and normal background of stars, which is crossing, that the test particle is crossing during its motion. So by gravitational deflection, it creates an overdensity on the back of the motion. And of course, this causes a deceleration, because there is an overdensity on the back with respect to the place where the object is pointing out. And so this causes a deceleration, which is proportional to the density contrast, times to the average values of the distribution function, distribution in phase space of the objects of the background. But the distribution in phase space has an immediate proxy in our mind, which is the density in the real space divided by the elementary volume in the velocity space, which is sigma cubed by definition. And so we know also that delta rho over rho is simply scalar divide or acceleration, which is going as 1 over the mass of the test particle divided by the density in the phase space. Which means that if you have a sufficiently massive test particle or a sufficiently dense in phase space environment, you can allow the test particle to decay rapidly to the center. And of course, it depends on the detail, because it is not so clear that you can get it. But it is not absurd, and indeed it was done. What is the problem? That during the dynamical friction decay into the center, the cluster, which is a finite sight object, can see the internal degrees of freedom excited by the presence of the dynamical friction itself. There is a feedback of dynamical friction on the inner motion of stars. The stars of the globular cluster are heated up by the orbital decay energy that is going in part into the internal degrees of freedom of the stars of the cluster. What does it mean? that you have to keep under control something in order to understand what is happening. One thing is the binding energy of the cluster. The binding energy of the cluster is simply the mass divided by the typical radius of the cluster. So it is the energy needed to destroy the cluster respect to the orbital energy. It is quite clear that whether this ratio would be enormous, the globular cluster is almost, you cannot destroy the globular cluster because you need an enormous quantity of binding energy and you cannot get it from the orbital energy, which is much lower. But unfortunately, this is not. With another back on the Hadron calculation, I see that in the same case or globular cluster motion in homogeneous potential, etc., etc., this ratio is actually in this strange range, which is between 2/5 and 6/5, in the sense that if the globular cluster is moving out of the galaxy, I mean the standard part of the galaxy, of course the binding energy is large respect to the orbital energy, because if the orbit is a large orbit, the orbital energy is by definition an energy which is not particularly significant. Why? It changes significantly when you have the cluster moving in the central region of the galaxy. You simply put this equal to zero and you can get 2/5 under reasonable hypothesis of these ratios here. The reasonable hypothesis that I have done is simply that I have a bulge which is about 100 times the mass of the globular cluster, and on the other side, because I am a mathematician who is also lazy, I give the same hypothesis for RB over RG. So the bulge radius is 100 times the radius of the globular cluster. So you have simply 2/5, and so this is 2/5 because you are buzzing around the center, and this is zero. While if you put your globular cluster on an orbit which is on the boundary of the bulge, you get, of course, a 6/5. So what is the problem? But then during the innermost evolution of the globular cluster, so due to the orbital decay of the globular cluster, the globular cluster enter progressively into the inner region of the galaxy. And so even if this ratio was starting from 6/5, it goes to a value which is less than 1. So that means it is getting in a region where it is intrinsically fragile, and so it can be destroyed before reaching the very center. And if it doesn't reach the very center, all the hypotheses in a nuclear cluster are formed by the accumulation of globular cluster by migration breaks down because it is destroyed before going there. The problem is this is a typical nonlinear problem, so you cannot scale this way to think about the reality. You have to do a real numerical simulation and body simulation, etc. By the way, with some back on the envelope calculation, you see that the framework is clear and can be worked out with some more detail. Okay, now go back a little bit to the singularity compact massive object in the center of galaxy. So the massive black hole, everyone knows, okay, this very famous image of the shadow of the M87 black hole, etc., etc., whose mass has been deduced to be of the order 6.5×10⁹ solar mass, etc., etc., with the Event Horizon Telescope. But what about our Milky Way? We have not this clear evidence of the shadow. And there are technical problems, of course, but one also could say, but maybe that our hypothetical massive black hole in the center of the galaxy is not really a Schwarzschild singularity, something else, just matter compressed within a certain size, which we know what is the certain size. The certain size is in our galaxy defined by the beautiful presence of a set of stars buzzing around the Sagittarius A star radio source, which is something that we have seen maybe several times in scientific presentation, etc., etc., which is the reproduction of the observation of the motion of a set of few tenths of stars in a region which is close to the Sagittarius A radio source, but not that close on a relativistic point of view. This is the S2, which is the shortest period star observed moving around Sagittarius A-star, how short the period is of the order of 16 years, actually. And its pericentric distance, which is not the smallest, because there is another star with a longer period, which is S14, which has an even shorter pericentric distance to the Sagittarius star, is of the order of 120 astronomical units for S2, of 90 astronomical units for S14. In any case, this is a very short length. I mean, it is a very short distance to the center, to the Sagittarius A radius, but it's not that short on a relativistic point of view, because in any case, on the order 1,000 Schwarzschild radius. So we are not really sampling the real strong field regime. We are in the intermediate field regime. It is not Newtonian, but it is not strongly relativistic. How can I say it? Because there is a paper where they show that there is an evidence of gravitational redshift for both S2 and S14, but S2 has been the one most studied star for some. So, in order to explain the actual motion of S2, you cannot rely on the pure Newtonian dynamics, but you cannot solve the problem with general relativity, because, as you know, in general relativity, only the one-body problem is solved in spherical symmetry. If you go to the two-body problem, you need Luciano-Rezzolla and others with enormous computers to give the solution. And so what has been done is to deal with the topic of the motion of this star surrounded supermassive black hole, or what is considered supermassive black hole, by n-body simulation, where the deviation from Newtonian gravitation is being considered via the so-called post-Newtonian treatment, that I will say so. So post-Newtonian treatment is needed in order to explain the motion of this star around the so-called massive black hole, but does not give any certainty about the fact that you need really a supermassive black hole. You just need a very high mass within the size of the innermost orbit. But it could be a nuclear star cluster, which is very, very dense, or something else, a boson star, strange hypothesis that can be raised. Again, we sort of back on the envelope calculation, which is not really back on the end, because you need a computer to do it. These are the real trajectory observed by the two essential main groups dealing with such stars around the massive black hole in the center of a galaxy. One is the USLA, and the other one is the Max Planck in Garching. And you see, the scale is that 1 second here is 40 milliparsec. So the closest distance to the center of this picture, which is the pericenter of a couple of stars here, is of the order of 0.6 milliparsec. 1 milliparsec is 1 parsec divided by 1,000. Okay, if you use a normal sophisticated n-body code and you get some initial condition from observation, this is what you obtain with numerical integration. So there is almost a perfect superposition, and you get the same perfect superposition even if you switched off the post-Newtonian term, because the post-Newtonian term gives gravitational redshift, which has not a direct counterpart on the trajectory. The only direct counterpart of the trajectory due to deviation from Newtonian gravity is the precession of the orbits. But in order to appreciate some precession on the orbit, you need some periods. And unfortunately, the shorter period is 16 years, and the length in time of this observation is of the order of 17 or 18. So we have not enough information about the real precession in order to pick whether the precession is due to deviation from Newtonian gravity or the normal precession you have in a spherically symmetrical Newtonian potential. Because in a spherical symmetrical Newtonian potential, we have precession. The only one which doesn't give precession is the point mass, or the homogeneous sphere, but it is another case. Otherwise, you always have a precession, and so you have to distinguish the different cases. Okay, this is from the Mary's book, which is a beautiful collection of the data about those stars buzzing around the center of our galaxy, etc. Where in yellow we have the minimum values. For example, this is the minimum semi-major axis of all the stars, which is 5 milliparsec, which has also the shortest period, 16 years. While in green we have the largest value. For example, the most eccentric orbit is of this S14 star, which is almost a straight line because the eccentricity is 0.963. So a straight line radial motion is E equal 1. And this is the largest period for all that set of stars, which is 1700 years. So you can imagine that in order to check if this star is processing, you need to collect an enormous quantity of data in the future. Okay, so let's go to what finally, eventually, something on my contribution in this frame. Some reference scale that I have already cited, the mass of the putative black hole in our galaxy is 4 million solar masses, it is quite clear. The pericenters of those stars, S stars that we show, are of the smallest pericenter, or the order of a few milliparsec. The Schwarzschild radius, which is the other typical scale we are dealing with, is of the order of 0.08 astronomical unit, which is of the order of 1,000 less than the few milliparsec of the pericenter. While another important parameter, which is the so-called BH influence radius, which is the size of the sphere around the massive object, where dynamics is dominated just by the massive object, you can neglect the external potential, is something, fortunately, much larger than both the other two scales. So we are in a regime where the pericenter distance of our test particles, the S-stars, are in between the Schwarzschild radius, factor 1,000 larger, but a factor of 10 to the 6 or more smaller than the influence radius. That means that your dynamical problem is just that of the interaction of objects in an empty sphere around a possible singularity. Which is, complicated, but not that complicated, because you can neglect all the other stars of the galaxy, which are almost non-present in that place. So what I have done with some collaborator of mine, I've done a sort of exercise, and I said, okay, let us suppose that we have 4 million solar masses, which are contained into a length scale which is small respect to the pericenter of the external particle. Suppose they are in the form of a cluster of objects, and let us see what is happening. Of course, we have done some choices about this set of particles which are moving in the very center and mimic the external potential of a massive black hole. We have seen that in the case we have a scheme, which is the one that I defined before, an astrophysical motivated framework, where massive globular clusters are moving to the center of the galaxy, carrying with them an intermediate mass black hole, which has the mass which is defined by some scaling law, and these intermediate mass black hole go to the center of the galaxy and are packed within a scale which is smaller respect to the pericenter of the moving around stars, we can study an astrophysically extremely violent environment for dynamics, which is the most dynamical violent environment you can think of. Because if you pack 400 intermediate mass black hole, each 10 to the 4 solar masses, in order to have a total mass which is the same of the massive black hole, and you put them even in a sort of virial initial equilibrium, you have that the crossing time, which is the reference time you have to deal with in a dynamical fashion, is extremely short, is 1 month and 8 days. So the dynamics is absolutely violent. So is it possible to follow numerical such an incredible dynamical problem? Yes, just if you use some particularly suited code, like one high precision direct summation code, where you regularize the very close interaction of massive objects, and so you make some time-space transformation in order to transform the Newtonian singularity into a sort of, this is due to Levi Civita originally, to a sort of a new potential which is actually an harmonic potential, so without any singularity. You include also what is needed, which are post-Newtonian terms, because you are in a regime where normal Newtonian gravitation is absolutely non-valid, and make this code running, you actually can try to find some result. And what was the result I was looking for? The result is that, is it possible that such kind of system, 400 intermediate mass black hole path in the very central region of a galaxy, resist up to many, many years without shrinking and giving rise to a supermassive black hole by subsequent following merger? The result is that this system is not stable. So actually, it undergoes to a sequence of merger, and one of these intermediate mass black hole at a certain time becomes dominating in mass, and it is a sort of attraction zones where it is possible it captures other black holes, and so there is the growth of a supermassive black hole seed. So what is practically the result we got? Okay, sorry, I want to give you some astrophysical substance to the scheme. Okay, we have the hypothesis that globular clusters are moving in an external potential, so they are orbitally decaying, they survive to the center. Each of them is carrying in the center an intermediate mass black hole. The mass of an intermediate mass black hole is 10 to the 7 solar masses, which means that the globular cluster host should be 10 to the 7 solar mass. Okay, which is, I mean, with 10 to the 7 solar mass for the globular cluster host, you can see that dynamic coefficient is efficient. So if the globular cluster host was 10 to the 7, you have contemporary two good things. That dynamic coefficient has been efficient in 1 giga year to carry to the center, and it is also hosting a 10 to the 4 solar mass intermediate mass black hole. You need 400 of them, of course, but we don't know. We don't know what was the population of globular massive globular cluster at the early ages of our galaxy. So this is just to show what is the evolution in time of the intermediate mass black hole cluster, each of them composed by 400 objects with 10 to the 4 solar masses. Okay. The red dot is the barycenter of the system, which is moving a little bit around because of the, non-symmetrical ejection of objects. And so, of course, the barycenter is moving for that because it is conserved, but not to respect to the initial frame. So it is that what happens is that there is an agglomeration and a very fast expulsion of objects around, and the inner merger of a sequence of objects that you cannot see in this animation, but I can show you later. And this is a sort of zoom of what happened to the growing SBH object in the center of the galaxy. So in the very initial stages, the growing SBH, so you have one of the 400 object, which is starting to accrete other black holes, emitting gravitational wave, of course, at each stage, and it is starting to moving around in a sort of Brownian motion around the center. So at the beginning, the Brownian motion was quite limited, while in a later stage, the Brownian motion is no more Brownian, in the sense that it is moving out just because there is the conservation of the momentum. The expulsion of objects on one side is making the growing remnant SBH to move on the other side. So it is moving in the galaxy in a dimension which is still relatively small, but is getting of the order of the milliparsec. So this can be a significant observational feature to keep in mind when comparing with the observation. So this is the most relevant, probably, output of our work. After making some different sampling from the same initial physical initial condition, because this is a chaotic problem, this is the ergodic and body problem, if you don't make some statistic, you have not a significant result, just because of the Lyapunov exponent make the solution individually exploring. So we have done some sampling from the initial condition, the same initial condition, some from different sampling seed starting with, and we saw that if you look, this is in a function of time. You see, the time scale is something ridiculous because for a sophistical side, we have a total evolution of the system up to 400 years, which is nothing. So the dynamics is very violent in the in the initial 50 years of evolution. You see that the fraction of the total mass which is going into a single object, so the growth of the black hole seed, is such that up to 400 years, in the different cases, so making an average, we have this curve here, which is a sort of average curve about the 10 different initial samples, more than 20% of the total mass has gone into a single massive black hole. So that means that in our case, the initial 10 to the 4 solar mass, intermediate mass black hole, in 400 years has grown its mass up to 800,000 solar masses. Okay, so if you make a simple scaling and say, okay, but because you have just 400 objects you could, just because your code didn't allow you to follow more than 400 objects, because it's so precise, so slow, et cetera, et cetera. What would have happened if you increase the initial number of objects? Okay, if you have 2,000 intermediate mass black hole, each of them 10 to the 4 solar mass in size, you, with efficiency of 25%, can grow up to the Sagittarius A star mass in the same time scale, actually in a shorter time scale because the crossing time is getting smaller. So actually, with a normal dissipationless dynamical evolution, you can grow a massive black hole like the one we see in our galaxy without the need of gas, etc., but basing on the astrophysical hypothesis that the migration origin for the distribution of objects around the galaxy is a valid one. Okay, the successive mergers that give as a final result a very massive black hole due to the merger of the intermediate mass black hole should have, of course, some gravitational wave influence, a signature, and indeed it is. In this plot, we see the various green spikes, which are the energy radiated away for each merger. So we have a sequence of merger from the initial times up to the final times, where we have a significant, very huge merger, because now, at this time, the grown-up massive black hole is of the order of 800,000 solar masses. So it's very huge in mass, so even a single merger with another 10 to the 4 solar mass companion give rise to a very large gravitational energy radiated away. How large in a cumulative way? This way. We have here in the ordinate the quantity of energy radiated away in gravitational wave in units of the initial gravitational energy as a function of time. You have, of course, a stepwise function because each step corresponds to a single merger. Some of you can say, okay, you are probably wrong, because how is it possible that you have, in this case, something larger than one? It is not wrong, because this is the initial gravitational energy, so you can easily radiate away by gravitational wave much more than the initial gravitational energy, just because the initial gravitational energy is the pair-to-pair gravitational energy, while the total tank reservoir is total mass times C squared.
And if you plot it, a total energy radiated away divided by total mass times c squared, you have, of course, here very small numbers. But this is just to ensure you that it is not an error. It is completely under control. It is interesting because you can release 40% more than the initial gravitational energy just due to subsequent mergers of black hole in such kind of very, very violent environment. So I am almost done, and I think that we can finish here. And just because I like to make some advertisement, and I'm sorry to bother you about it, this is a book that I very recently published with Springer, which deals with classical Newtonian gravity, which I think is the most fundamental even in astrophysics, even if in my talk I refer often to non-classical, non-Newtonian gravity, but it is a book in the Unitext for Physics series, which is, it's a textbook, which is resuming some fundamentals of classical Newtonian gravity, which is, of course, present in many books in the various libraries, but not just probably in a single book, in an easy and comprehensive way with some example and exercise. So excuse me for the advertisement and the final, consideration out of the scientific environment, but not completely out. And thank you again for patience in listening. Yes, sorry. I thought that you were not coming, so I didn't spoke about some detail that I'm sure you appreciate. Yes, of course, because in our code, we have the treatment in a post-Newtonian way of the kick resulting from the merging of objects with different spin. We got the, let's say, prescription for this from the classical Campanelli and Laguna paper, etc. And we put it into our numerical code, and we chose an initial distribution of spin for the intermediate mass black hole. So actually, in this code, we have the results, which are somewhat depending on this initial assumption that, of course, I didn't have the time to talk. But we consider it, yes.
Of course, in this exercise, you make a very strange, very, very extreme initial assumption. Because you said that you need 1 billion years to put a cluster in the center, and then you start with 400 objects that are already there. And while you are aiming 400 years, they create a completely different object. So, of course, you cannot expect that this is a realistic computation. So, what you need is to understand what happens if you add the slowing in the objects. On time scale,
yes, of course,
much larger than the evolution of this.
Raffaele, I know you are clever, and of course, you probably know that I have the answer for this. Yes, this is the second step. Actually, what we check is that if you have an initial population of globular class of 10 to the 7 solar mass, in just 1 giga year, they fall onto the center. But of course, they are not falling contemporary at the same time. So the real initial condition is something that are coming from the subsequent mergers and falling in of cluster, which are likely giving a less violent dynamics. So on one side, it is more realistic. On the other side, it is not the better way to test the violent dynamics. The final result can be different, and of course, this should be done. And we hadn't had the time yet to do it, but of course, this is the second step.
Yes.
Sorry, you under,
All the participants you simulate have the same mass.
Yes.
So maybe if you want more violent dynamics, even more than this, you could have a range of masses, and then the thing would fall apart if it's possible.
Yes, of course. I give you an answer, which is also an answer to Raffaele. The real initial topic of this work was simply, can we distinguish two situations? One, we have a supermassive black hole in the center, which is moving the stars in the way that we saw as given by the S2 and S14, etc., stars observed by the Garching and the other group. And the other one, what happened in a physical frame if we consider an alternative possibility? You have a set of objects whose total mass is the same of the singularity, and is it stable or not, for example. So what we saw is it is not stable on time scale of the order 500 years. And this was the first interesting result, because at the moment, I can exclude my initial idea that is it possible to keep some very dense cluster for long enough to justify what we are seeing around it in the observation. And so I hadn't any further things to test in my mind. This was my first topic. The problem, real problem, is that this result is not really significant. Why? Because, as probably every one of you know, even to keep a globular cluster stable, you need binaries. Because it is the only way where you can survive against the gravothermal collapse. Because a lot of the orbital order energy goes into internal degrees of freedom binaries, which constitute a source of heating up of the system, which keeps the globular cluster alive against gravothermal collapse. In our simulation, we didn't put any intermediate mass black hole in binaries. Why? Because it is too complicated to do it computationally. But probably, in the case that a significant fraction of the intermediate mass black hole were in binary system, you could have allowed it to survive in a stable state for a long while. I don't know, it's very difficult to say.
I'm not really sure about that, because, well, I think that even if you didn't put binaries in the initial condition, then you have binaries during evolution that forms a biological body.
No, because you have post-Newtonian terms. So when you are trying to form a binary by a triple interaction, usually if the binary is sufficiently close, there is the starting of gravitational wave emission, and so the binary doesn't survive enough to give the role of against the radial collapse, because it merges, and so it is no more a binary. But I need to. But they are too short-lived to allow the system to heat up gravitationally enough to survive to the collapse. That's the problem. In a purely Newtonian simulation, you have this, but this is not the reality, because you are out of the Newtonian frame. So if you switch off, we have done the exercise. If we switch off the post-Newtonian term with the same initial condition, etc., etc., first of all, the integration gets lower in an incredible way just because of the formation of binaries. And indeed, in that case, you have a sort of stability, metastability of the system due to that. But this is not the real frame, because in this regime, you cannot switch off the non-Newtonian terms, because you are out of the validity of the Newtonian simulation.
May I have a question?
Yes.
Maybe I have missed an important part of your talk, but what I don't see very clear is the correlation between the nuclear massive objects and the formation of a supermassive or massive black hole at the center. The idea that I understood is that you put together these clusters, they merge towards the center and they give rise to this. Mm. But the initial objects, are they objects of the same age, like globular clusters, or is there the possibility that these initial objects span a wide range of ages? Because in that case, we would see also contamination in terms of stellar population towards the galactic center. And as far as I know, the galactic bulk seems to be fairly homogeneous in age and in, say, the chemical properties.
But here you are.
Now, where is the, mm.
The problem is that your consideration of Coast Valley, we are here well within the resolution scale for your kind of observational mind. In the sense, we are here well within the black hole influence radius, which is by definition a place where the buzzing around stars are negligible on a dynamical point of view. So it is an empty space where you have either a singularity or a compact object, which is inducing some external motion. So you don't see anything but those test particles, which are the S-star served by Gatching or UCLA group, etc. So you have no further information about chemical composition, so you have to go outward. Yeah, but if you go outward, this is not relevant for this.
That these objects go straight toward the center, they don't interact at all with the environment, they keeping their own properties, there is this region.
This is the hypothesis.
Dynamics, the complicated dynamics take place, and no contamination to the surroundings.
No, the contamination, it is, but on larger scale. Indeed, what is observed is that the so-called nuclear cluster in our galaxy, which is around with a five parsec scale around the supermassive black hole, what is considered supermassive black hole, is composed by two different populations, one young stellar component and one old stellar component. And they have different radial profiles, they have different metallicity, etc., etc. But we are talking about five parsec scale, which is by far larger than the one we are dealing with. So it is another topic. But anyway, the heterogeneity is present. But the heterogeneity is also something that can come by the migration scenario. Because if you assume that, like, it is quite reasonable that there is a metallicity mass correlation, the 10 to the 7 solar massive progenitors, or what I was talking about, were probably likely more massive, more metal abundant than the Renna. So, but by the way, it refers to a larger length scale, which is not the one of interest in this particular work. I mean, in other works, yes.
Are
there any other questions?
If not, we can thank
you. Ti ringrazio, sì, quello che...